that time of the day on Wednesday night when everybody gets together and we start doing some Let's Talkin' Racing. So Let's Talk Racing is live and rolling to you right now over the good old internet. And I dare say,
our first caller.
Let's Talk Racing. Is this David?
Yes.
Wow, well, that's a good thing.
Heck yeah, it is. Who's this?
This is Roger, and you got Mary with you tonight. You're also on the show.
Hi, Roger, Mary.
Hello.
So, how's everything been going for you? I see a lot of stuff been changing and being talked about.
Man, everything's going great. Just excited to be back on the track.
Well, that's good. So, tell us a little bit about the new team that you're working with.
You guys, y'all there?
Yeah, we're here.
We're here.
Hello.
Hello, hello.
Can you hear us at all, David?
Hello?
Can you hear us now?
David, can you hear us at all? We had trouble with this one last week.
Hey, David, go ahead and try calling back. Okay, I reckon that means he'll be calling back.
Who was it last week we had that couldn't hear us for a while that hung up and called back?
Don't remember.
See, he did that last week too. Remember it rang one time? It rang the second time I answered.
Let's try to see if technology works better this time.
I think it will. How you doing, Roger?
Good. I just asked a question about, tell us a little bit of something about the new team you're racing with.
Well, man, I've joined up with RSS Racing, and Ryan Sieg is the main driver, and then Rod Sieg and Pam on the team, and man, those guys have really done an awesome job over these years. I think Ryan's 11th in points, and just running strong every race, and we just joined up with them for Daytona 2 races ago, and man, we couldn't be more excited to partner up with them and be part of their organization and to grow. We got a 2-car team now, and just excited, looking forward to getting up to Loudon, New Hampshire this weekend. But you know, with some great sponsors, I was able to put a deal together with RSS Racing, and now we're back on the track racing. So it's pretty exciting.
Well, go ahead, give a shout out for your sponsors so we can give them some credit.
Well, there's so many of them. Our main one is MassimoMotors.com. It's a UTV, ATV buggy, side-by-side buggies, and man, they're awesome, awesome buggies, and we're glad to have them on board. We have another company called Striping Technologies, Dealer Associates, Winco Stamping, Davis Wrecker, Stevie Lumber Company, Ace High Ranch, Pit Crew Car Care Products, Blast Control, AB Rent to Own, Central Texas Lakes and Plaster, Texas Farms and Ranches. I mean, you know, we have so many different types of sponsors, and just thankful for them, because without the different companies and the people supporting you and helping you, you couldn't be out there racing at the level we race at. So we're just thankful for them.
Well, good deal. I mean, it's lovely to have a lot of sponsors to keep you racing the way you want to be. Go ahead.
No doubt about that. It's wonderful.
So, with all those sponsors, I would think you guys might want to try to maybe do a little cup. Listen to me. Bad. get up in the next level.
We really like the NASCAR Xfinity Series. It's very competitive. It's a great series, and man, it's really competitive. Now NASCAR has the Chase format and the Camping World Truck Series and the NASCAR Xfinity Series as well, and that's going to be really exciting and new for the fans and the drivers this season. And unfortunately, we won't be a part of it, but it's really cool for our sport. And again, just glad to be back out there racing. We had a great run at Daytona 2 weeks ago. Unfortunately, we got tied up in a wreck right there towards the end with about 3 laps to go. And last week was having a great run, and we had a right front tire come apart and had to make a pit stop, lost a couple laps. But all in all, just the last 2 races have been really, really exciting and good for us. And And like I said earlier, looking forward to getting to New Hampshire, racing there. It's always a great track, very flat, and always exciting.
Okay. Now, normally I usually ask everybody to tell everybody something about you so that the people that are watching get to know where you came from in racing and how you got to be where you are now.
Well, man, I've been involved really in it my whole life. My dad was a crew chief for a guy named Ronnie Chumley and Tony Bittenhausen Jr. When I was born up until I was about 7, my dad got out of the industry and I kind of fueled that passion, and by then, man, I was just, that's all I could think about as a 6-7-year-old kid is racing, and so my dad quit because he traveled a lot, and I had a couple other brothers, and my mom didn't like him being gone all the time, but anyway, my neighbor raced dirt cars, and man, I continued to go to the racetrack with my neighbors, and when I was 14, I built my first bomber dirt car, and it just kind of took off from that point on, and been racing ever since, and it's just great to be able to live out a childhood dream, and just like most people out here in America that are racing across the country to different short tracks, whether it be asphalt or dirt, just had a dream and desire, and fortunate to be living it today.
Good deal.
Cool.
When I was 14, I built my first
Jessica was trying to tell me on text that she can't watch us, and I was double checking it, and all of a sudden it popped up just as you finished answering.
Awesome.
Sitting here watching it on my phone at the same time.
So now where did you grow up, David?
Well, I was born and raised in Houston, Texas, and now I live up in the Dallas, Texas area. My uncle owns the NASCAR racing school based at the Texas Motor Speedway. We got about 50 NASCAR stock cars, and okay, been to NASCAR racing school at Texas Motor Speedway since it first opened. And I don't know, years ago, back in 1996, the team Rear Morrison, a professional drag racing team, they were actually the ones that took me NASCAR Camp Oil Truck Series racing, and I moved up here to the area back in 1996. Been here ever since, but I was born and raised in Houston. Down there where it's hot.
Yeah, exactly. Very hot. Of course, it's been kind of hot up here too lately. But anyway, but that's good. All right, so you started out with dirt, and then you switched to asphalt. Which do you prefer?
Man, I love it all. You know, I'm just, I love to race, love to compete. Obviously, I like asphalt racing, but, you know, dirt racing, really, I was very lucky that I started up that we had a lot of dirt tracks in Texas, and had a lot of opportunity to drive different stock cars and late model dirt cars growing up. But man, racing on the dirt is exciting. It really teaches you great car control. Mm-hmm. And my favorites, you know, I love dirt racing, don't get me wrong. We used to race on these 3/8 mile dirt tracks and 1/2 mile dirt tracks and travel around the country. But it's pretty awesome, you know. It's just pretty awesome. I love dirt racing, but you know, once I made it to the late model asphalt cars, and then the NASCAR Camp World Truck Series, pretty much over the years, it's really taken up my time. Pretty much race every race, and what little time I have, I try to catch a dirt race or go watch one or drive a dirt car somewhere, but. I love it all, really, but man, dirt racing really taught me how to race, and I'm a big fan of it now. Always have been.
I know the first one I ever went to, it wasn't, say, stock cars on the dirt, but it was, I guess it was the carts, and it was in Richmond, and there was a dirt track, and the carts raced. And I mean, it's like you would see them, and then a big puff of dirt would go by, and you wouldn't see them for a few minutes, and you could see them, and you know, maneuver through the dirt. So it was wild. I was hooked after that, wanting to go to the dirt track. Whereas before, it was always go to Southside Speedway and, you know, hang out with the guys on the asphalt. But yeah, that was a lot of fun.
But, yeah, no doubt about it. But the you know, dirt racing, you know, it's just the racetrack. There's so much change in the dirt does. It's tacky, and then next thing you know, after all the heat races and some B features, that you start out the feature track's kind of tacky, then it changes over to dry slick, and I don't know, it really, for me personally, it just taught me how to really be it taught me great car control and taught me how to be a good race car driver, the dirt racing did, and I'm a big fan of it today, and
I still love to go sit in the stands and watch a great dirt race.
That's cool. All right, so tell us a little bit about your Craftsman Truck Series. What year you started and who you drove for. And
wow, you know, I started in 1997, and man, I drove for so many different people. The one that's probably the one I drove for the most was the Wayne Spears, the 75 Truck Series team. I was there for, I think, 6 years I drove for that team. But had a long career in the NASCAR Camp World Truck Series, I think 16 years. And during those 16 years, I would, you know, I'd always dabble, do a little bit of Busch Series racing then, what they called it now, right, Xfinity Series. And, but, you know, whether you're racing pickup trucks or cars, I just love to compete, and it's a lot of fun. And to be part of NASCAR is just, like I said, to make a living and doing what you dream of doing is just
dream come true, yeah. Every person's dream to get out there and to be able to drive fast and have fun.
No doubt about it.
Okay, so then you left trucks and you went to what's now the Xfinity Series. So who else have you driven for in the Xfinity Series?
Well, I drove for, you know, TriStar Motorsports, and now I'm with RSS Ryan T Racing, and since I jumped over to the Xfinity Series full time 2 years ago. That's the two teams that I've been with.
Okay. Because I was telling Roger a few minutes ago that with TriStar, one of my friends used to be one of the Jackmen, Kevin T. I don't know if you remember him. And then Nemo used to be one of the hauler drivers for TriStar.
Right, right.
They're friends. And
yeah, both of those guys are great guys.
Yeah, and it's funny to see who's on what team this year and who they go to next, because Nemo is with Roush now.
Right. Well, you know, it's really interesting in our industry. Guys are really good, and you know, there's a lot of change around. Once you do a good job, other people want to recruit you, and there's a lot of movement in our sport. And one of the things, I don't know if I'm real crazy about it, once you get a group of guys together, you try to hold them together, because that's kind of the nucleus of the team. And when somebody gets a chance or an opportunity to better themselves or make more money, you can't blame them. But I always like to keep the same group of guys together, but it's challenging to do that in our sport.
Oh, yeah. Exactly. And once you have a team that meshes together, that knows you, knows the vehicle, and can work together, that's all what a pit stop is.
You said that again, ma'am? I'm sorry.
I said when you find a group of guys, say five or six, that can work with you, that work together, it all comes together for the team to make your pit stop the best that it can be.
No doubt. Well, you know, you brought up a great point. Our sport is so much about teamwork, and you know, it's the driver and the crew chief get a lot of the recognition, but it's everybody. It's everybody involved: the mechanics, the tire changers, the jack bands, you know, the engine builders, the engineers. Just, you know, there's so many different people on the team that make it what it is. And heck, if it was just me on the team, heck, I wouldn't even leave my house. But everybody plays a major part, and it's, you know, teamwork in NASCAR, it's everything about our sport, no doubt.
Exactly.
Hey, when you were growing up and watching racing, David, who was your mentor or who was your favorite person you liked to watch or follow?
Well, I mean, my dad was a crew chief for a guy named Ronnie Chumley, and, man, Ronnie, I was a young kid, but, man, he was good. And he raced a lot with A.J. Foyt, but Ronnie was really good. I really, as a young kid, I watched him a lot, paid attention to how he carried himself and how he drove. You know, not only was he a great race car driver, he really could build the race cars too, and that was really cool. But, you know, somebody I was growing up was A.J. Foyt, being from Houston, Texas, and A.J. being, you know, probably the biggest star in auto racing. You know, I read a lot about AJ and used to go over to his shop and just kind of be friends with all the crew guys. And I've seen AJ once or twice, and man, I just idolized him. And years later, back I think 2002, 2003, we became really great friends, and we're still great friends today. And it was really cool. I actually got a chance to drive one or two or three races. So just somebody that I idolized. And, you know, like everybody else, you think of stock car racing, you think of Richard Petty, and he was another one that I really learned a lot about by reading books and watching him race, and he was somebody that I idolized a lot too, you know, but two of our biggest superstars in auto racing, but they're both great friends of mine, and it's pretty neat to see them now, but anyway, those are two of my, some of my biggest idols when I was a kid growing up.
Well, at least you didn't do what my son did. We went to Richard Petty's one time to his house for it was Richard Petty Day or something like that. And I guess my son was like 9 or 10, and he drew Richard a car, and he went up in front of like God and 300 and some people and told Richard what was wrong with his cars. I wanted to crawl underneath that holler and die. I was so embarrassed, but.
Is that one of those moments you want to run and hide?
Oh, yes. And thank God Richard had a sense of humor. He just smiled, nodded his head, and I'm thinking, boy, I bet you I'd like to know what he said when I left.
He's probably saying, I got a lot of engineers that are still working on that problem as it is.
Yeah, he's a class act. And, you know, you'll have that every once in a while. Somebody wants to tell you what's wrong and how to do it better. And then all you do is smile, listen to them, and agree with them and move on.
Well, I can say now, my son has graduated college, and he's at Oak Ridge National Lab. So last spring, they 3D laser printed a Cobra Mustang. So I guess he's on the right track, okay?
Yeah, no doubt about that. Congratulations, Tony.
I'd like to see when they start trying to 3D print some of these race cars, you know.
Well, they're going to live 3D print tomorrow on Facebook. It's like a four-wheel drive vehicle. They're going to do a live version of it.
Huh.
Wow.
Interesting.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember one year out of the track, I was talking with Richard, and just happened to be when the tire guy came by with the tire bill. And I said, oh my God, I could buy two cars with as much as it costs just for a tire bill for one race. It's like $36,000.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's a, you know, NASCAR does a pretty good job just, you know, to kind of keep the playing field equal. They only allow you like five or six sets of tires per track.
Mm-hmm.
And what it does for the team, the big powerhouse teams that have plenty of funding and then for the teams that don't have a lot of funding, it kind of somewhat keeps it equal because some of those big powerhouse teams, they could probably buy endless amounts of tires. And then look at the second part of the field, you know, they're struggling to buy even five sets. So NASCAR does a good job to try to keep the cost down with the tires. But like you said, this, you know, I think it's $2,250 for a set of tires. It's pretty brutal, you know, when the race is over and that tire bill comes, but it's not cheap, that's for sure, and that's why we're all thankful for these sponsors so we can race.
I tell you what, I used to race late models. I definitely appreciated when I saw that my tire bill was only $500 a week, basically.
Yeah, but still, you know, no matter what type of racing you do, whether it's a Legends car, a Bandolero, or a late model asphalt, it don't matter. It's all expensive, you know, and you just do the best you can. If you can afford it and have good stuff, that's wonderful. But I always tell people, the people I meet at the track, ask them what kind of racing they do, and they tell me and show me pictures, you know. I said, man, I wish I could race NASCAR. I said, well, you probably will one day, you know. And I said, I always tell them what you're doing. You're doing the same thing we're doing here. It's just a different level, you know. But it's all about, we all take the green flag, and we're all trying to get the checker flag first. Just Some types of racing cost more than others.
Exactly.
Oh, goodness. All right, David, but we'll go ahead and let you get out of here. We're going to have another fun person on the show. You ever heard of a guy named Tiger Tom Pistone?
Oh, man, yeah, historical. Yeah.
Oh, God, yes.
Oh, man, so much history behind Tiger Tom. Man, he's been doing this, I don't know how many years, 60-something years, but wow.
Oh, God, yes. Yeah. I've known him for a long time, and I'd always love talking to him. When I do the show, I schedule one guest, and then Tiger's got the rest of the show.
No, that's pretty cool. You know, just, you know, I read a bunch of stuff about Tiger and just see, you know, when he raced in NASCAR in the 50s and the 60s, and he raced a lot at that stadium in Chicago. I think it was Soldier Field.
Yep.
One of them, but man, the guy's done so much in our sport. It's pretty cool. It's neat you're going to have him on, so I'm going to say hello.
I will pass that along. If you want.
All right, buddy. Hey, thanks for y'all. Thanks for letting me spend a little time with y'all this evening.
Okay? Oh, we love doing
time
that.
With you in Richmond, then.
Yeah, really. We're going to have to hook up with you and say hi to you in Richmond.
Well, I look forward to seeing y'all then, okay? Thank y'all.
Awesome. Thank
all right,
you.
Dave.
Have a good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Hey, Roger.
Oh, man, I was going to say this was Domino's Pizza and your pizza was back ordered. Dadgummit.
I was thinking about getting one.
Oh, hey, great minds think alike. What can we say? Oh, we got Tiger Tom Pistone with us. By the way, David Starr said to say hi. We had him on just a few minutes ago.
Good.
He said he loves hearing about your exploits back in Chicago and at Soldier Field and all the crazy things you've done and all the good things you've done.
Who's he driving for now?
It's SIG. RSS Racing.
Yeah, RSS Racing now. It just changed over.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he was running for TriStar and then went over and got into the stuff with RSS.
Yeah, he's running the second car for RSS because Ryan Sieg is running, I guess, their primary car. And he says they're running two cars now.
Yep.
Good. Hey, Roger, I wanted to ask you, whatever happened to that alliance group that they were trying to get together, what happened to that?
Which alliance group?
The 25 team car team owners. Last year or the year before they were trying to get in, whatever happened to that?
I thought they had set up something between the, you're talking about the different teams? Where they were going to try to share resources of some sort, or for when they go different places, try to reduce the cost on their expenses for going to all the different tracks and stuff, for motels and such.
Okay.
I know they have an actual driver alliance thing too, like Tony Stewart, Kevin Harvick, and I forget how many other guys or drivers are in it. In fact, when Tony got that fine for fussing at NASCAR about the lug nuts, and they fined him $35,000, the drivers were going to pay for it until NASCAR told them no, they won't take nothing except a check that has Tony's signature on it.
Uh-huh.
So Tony wound up donating the other funds to charity, which they were all good with.
Right.
So, all right, I don't know what... plenty about you, but there are people out there that have yet to heard about you or are dying to ask these really deep questions. Mary's sitting over here, tell me this, tell me that. I said, no, you can ask him when we get him on here.
Yeah, okay, what does she want to know?
Well, give us a little bit of background about you. Tell all of us and our listeners a little bit about you, about your history.
What? You want to start from the beginning again?
Well, I know all about this, but that doesn't mean the new people that are listening don't know. So, I mean...
I know about NASCAR, but I don't know a lot about you. My dad did go to the 1948 Daytona, so I know a little bit to that far back.
What year did he go?
1948 Daytona.
The first one he went to.
The first one he went to.
Daytona?
Yes.
Yeah.
1948?
Yes, my dad, not me.
Yeah, her dad went to that race.
Wow, that's when NASCAR just started.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. My dad was in college, and he and his brothers and some drivers from Concord drove all night and went down to the race and took home movies.
What was his name?
Clem Llewellyn. He used to race under the name Jim Llewellyn, so his parents wouldn't find out. He was from Concord.
I ran a convertible circuit with him.
Okay.
Cool.
Yeah, 56 to 57. Jimmy Llewellyn drove convertibles.
Could have been.
Now you got her. Now you got her guessing now. She thought she knew more about her dad.
Yeah, that's Jimmy. Yeah, I knew Jimmy very well. He was a comedian, buddy. He was a comedian.
Cool. Now, so When did you actually start racing?
Let's see, 1950 at Soldier's Field in Chicago. That's when the cars were really strictly stock. And you'd go out in the junkyard and buy a car for $10, $15 and race them. So I raced Chicago, Rockford, Illinois, and Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And so from 1950 up to 1955, I won three championships in a row at all three tracks. So in 55, at the end of 55, Fred Lorenzen wanted to go racing, and I was his hero at the time. So I sold the car to him. And he bought the car, and he made a 56 out of it, and he came down south with me, and he tried to race, but that didn't last long. He went back home again. And I came NASCAR at the end of 55. I come out and ran NASCAR. My first race was at Martinsville, Virginia. And we stopped at this gas station in Winston-Salem. And the gas station was called Golden Esso. It was owned by Alvin Hawkins and Bill France Sr. So I stopped there to get some gas and get some information, and this big tall guy comes running out and he says, "Where are you going, son?" I said, "I'm going to Martinsville, Virginia." He said, "That race ran last week." So it was a week late. So
I would possibly think some other driver may have realized you were going to race and tell you were a week late just so you wouldn't show up.
I know, and Bill Frank Sr. let me use his gas station to work on the car and get ready to go to North Wilkesboro. And my first race is at North Wilkesboro, the dirt track. And I asked around, I said, "Who is the best drivers to follow?" They said, "Joe Weatherly and Curtis Turner." So I start following these guys in practice, and I kept saying to myself, "When are these guys going to back off?" The next thing I knew, I was on my roof.
Oh, no.
I landed on my roof. And the car was sitting upside down. And the officials come out and said, "Are you okay? I'm okay." I said, "Yeah." So this guy hit the seatbelt while I was upside down. I almost broke my neck.
Oh.
You know, so that was a big thrill. And I stayed in NASCAR for a long time.
Did you know another driver back in the 50s, Frank Mundy? They call him Frank Rebel Mundy, M-U-N-D-Y.
Murphy?
Mundy.
Rebel Murphy?
Yeah, Mundy.
Mundy.
No, I don't. Who?
Mundy, like M-U-N-D-A-Y, except M-U-N-D-Y.
They called him Frank Rebel Mundy, and he drove Mercury's.
I thought that was Frank Mundy.
Yes.
Yeah. They also,
Frank Mundy.
Yeah, yes. They also called him Rebel.
Yeah, he was from Atlanta, Georgia.
Cool. Hey, you were saying something. Go ahead.
He drove for Carl Kiekaber, if I wasn't mistaken.
You might be right. All I remember was he was my aunt and uncle's neighbor. He lived across the street, so he used to go over and let us play with all of his trophies, and he had a trophy room, and
yeah.
He used to...
Yeah, that's him. Frank Mundy. Yep, that's him.
You know, you were saying something about Martinsville, and it just reminded me of something. Don't they owe you a clock?
Well, back then, they didn't have none. Back then.
I was, if I were you, I'd still probably say, "Hey, guys, you know, cough one up."
That's a sore spot with me. I keep asking them, but they're not going to do nothing about it.
Yeah, I remember talking to Mike Smith about it, and he said something. "Well, tell him to show me the proof." And
yeah.
I said, "Okay." But Mike's not there no more, so they got a new PR guy there now.
Yeah. Martinsville is always my favorite track. But I wish they would give me a big clock. That'd be an honor to have.
I tell you what, I spent a day with you at Martinsville. And
I remember.
Yep, and I tell you what, it's hard to keep up with you.
It wore me out that day.
Who?
You did.
No, I think you wore your own self out. I had to stop and sit down a couple of times, and I'm usually a pretty good walker. I play a lot of tennis and got lots of leg strength, but man, you're just everywhere. I mean, you're like on fire with Red Bull pumped in your blood or something.
We're going to go this October if you want to join us.
When?
The next Martinville race.
Yeah, the next one. It's the last weekend in October, Halloween weekend.
Get me to be a grand marshal, I'll come up.
That might not be too hard to do, actually. You never know.
In 1966, Ford Motor Company pulled out of racing. And I was the only Ford left. I was independent. And Bill Frank Sr. bought me a motor. And I went up to Martinsville. There was no Fords there. And I led that race. And almost had the race won until my brakes went out. And Jim Pascoe and Paul Goldsmith said after the race that there was no way that they could have beat me, and that Ford Motor Company should be ashamed of themselves, because here's my car, 2 years old, and I was smoking off the Chrysler. And Clay Earls never thanked me for that, never.
Huh.
I thanked him for that. Never gave me a thank you, never.
Sometimes it's a thankless job, but as long as you've got it in your heart and it makes you feel good, that's what matters more than anything else, I think.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You're right. You've got 100%. You know, I went to Martinsville in 1957. I was driving a factory Chevrolet And in the middle of the race, it started drizzling. And I was leading the race, and Billy Myers was driving the Sir Phil Stratton Mercury. And he went over the hood of my car, and then going in turn one, he went through that concrete wall and into the grass up there.
Uh-huh.
And I thought that some kid got hurt and got killed. And I felt so bad about it, I went back home, and I never came back until the following year, and I found out that that nobody got hurt. That's how dumb I was. And Buck Baker ended up winning the race.
Oh, goodness. That wasn't where somebody told you that and just to keep you from coming there, right?
No, it was the truth. It was the truth because there's quite a few people out there.
Yeah.
Going in turn one, you know.
That's the nice thing about it at Martinsville there, one in turn one and two. They've got that nice little extra grass area out just
right
past the fence there. So.
Right, exactly.
Let's go
row
trees.
Yeah.
Bushes.
Row trees, bushes, yeah.
Flowers, whatever we
could. What track was that? Somebody went flying off the backstretch and one of the cars landed in a tree or something. I don't remember what track that was. Do you remember that one, Tiger?
No. I remember I landed a tree with an airplane.
I don't think I've done that one yet.
Yeah.
I've never been on my roof either, I can say that. I have flown through the air and landed on top of another car.
See, back in those days, Curtis Turner, Joe Weatherly, Paul Goldsmith, they all had airplanes.
Yeah.
And they used to land on the racetrack.
At Martinsville?
Yeah, Martinsville, all over the place. Well, Martinsville, I think it was in the back grassy area.
Yeah.
Pretty long strip over there. At Martinsville.
I tell you what. They should have just landed on the railroad track going beside it.
Yeah, you're right.
So, now, I know you have helped out lots of people in your racing career, and still do. I know you're real good friends with David Reagan. How's have you talked to him lately?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we keep in contact with each other. His father and I are real close friends, his father and I.
So that's how you guys wound up getting to know each other, was from his father?
Yeah, because Kenny was racing Grand National back then.
Oh, he was the one that was with you when I was with you at Martinsville, wasn't it?
Right, yeah, him and Adam.
Okay.
Yeah, I came up with David.
Cool.
Yeah.
Now,
do you remember you and I in the infield?
Yeah.
Not in the infield, in the big area, and we started to a girl by the name of Katie Vincey.
Caitlin?
This blonde girl.
Oh, yeah, I know Caitlin. She used to live down here by me.
Yeah, do you remember us walking up to her? And I walked up to her and I told her, I said, hey, Katie. I said, you are a very gorgeous person. I said, you're going to be the next you know, race from Starr. And she walked away from me. I guess she took it the wrong way.
Yeah. We've probably had her on the show back about 6 months ago. I'll have to try to text her or call her and ask her if she remembers that at Martinsville.
Yeah, yeah. I thought, you know, because she walked away, but I think she took it the wrong way.
I don't know. You didn't have a bad reputation, did you? That I didn't know about.
No. I'm very sociable to women.
Oh, you're sociable to everybody, Tiger.
Right.
I'll tell you what. Now, let me think here. I'm trying to get back to some other things you've talked to me about. God, there's so many, it makes it hard. Now, I know you like to work a lot with Legends cars and Bandoleros. How's that coming with some of the drivers that are coming up? And I know some of the guys that are still racing in the top three are doing some of the Legends and racing when it comes to Charlotte, stuff like that.
What happened to that is most of the guys that you taught how to work on these cars, they take the job away from you.
Uh-huh.
And just like my two grandsons that were in business against you. You know, you taught them everything, and then they go in business against you. And that's what's wrong with the racing right now. You know, there's too many of us trying to teach these kids how to drive. And it's all about money now. It's not about, you know, who you know. It's all about money.
Yeah.
It came to this.
Now, do you still have your shop and everything, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm still doing Legends and Bandoleros. I still sell to them. In fact, I'm trying to get a position to go on the road and start talking to all these dealers and officials at the racetracks. I'm trying to get a... Trying to do something like that.
Yeah, I was talking to, I wish I could remember the guy's name. He used to do a lot of the drive shafts for the race teams. Charlie Pat?
Charlotte?
I'm trying to remember. Doggone it! I've got it on a note paper somewhere. It's probably sitting in my house by my computer.
Well, it was Universal Service in Charlotte, and the guy's name was GE. He did all the dry shaft work for all the Ford teams and everything else. I don't know anybody else that was doing that. Tex Powell started doing that.
Does Charlie Patterson sound familiar?
Who?
Charlie Patterson.
Charlie Patterson. No. Text Powell, he's
been allowed that. Yeah. I'll have to look it up and text you with it later. But, yeah, shoot, I talked with him about an hour the other night on the phone about all the different stuff he used to do, and it was a blast listening to him. So I was telling him, you know, before too long we'll have him on the show. I should have, like, the two of y'all at the same time and just let y'all see how much stuff overlaps between each other.
Yeah, we could do that.
Here's a question for you. How many different car numbers have you raced in your lifetime?
Ooh, let's see. Number 3, number 50, number 16, number 50, number 59. That's about it.
Five. What about number 5?
Oh, yeah, I ran a convertible.
Yep.
And Soldier Steel. I won the race at number 5.
I'm cheating. I'm looking at your website at all the different color pictures of the cars.
Yeah, number 55. Yeah, 59 was my favorite number.
Yeah.
59.
Now, here's a hard question for you. When you were looking at going into racing, was there actually anybody there for you to look up and say, "Hey, I want to be like that driver"?
No, but see, back then, Andy Grant Kelly was running Soldier Steel, and he had all these California drivers down there. And back then you had to be 21 years of age. You had to be before you started driving.
Uh-huh.
And I never went to a race. You know, Jim Rathman and Vince Ignoffo, they had a muffler shop in Chicago, and I was getting some pipes put in my truck, and they told me, why don't you come down to Soldier Steel? So I went down there one night, next thing I knew, we went to the junkyard, we bought a car.
Uh-huh.
And the first year was my worst year because I didn't know what I was doing. But after that, you know, we won 3 years, we won three titles in a row. They couldn't touch us. So actually, it was Pat Flaherty in them days, Jim Rathman, you know, Gene Marmer, a lot of guys, Woody Sternquist, you know, Lou Faders. There's many guys like Dick Rathman, Jim Rathman. There's a lot of guys from Al Swanson and Al Shearer. You know, I guess Joe Shearer works for Jim Stoddard.
Uh-huh.
Father Al Shearer, that used to drive there. And then you had Bill Venerini. His father drove up there, Venerini. The racing just started up there when I started. So there was no name drivers that you want to be to because you were just all starting together.
So basically what it turned out being is that it was the role was flip-flopped and you now become the new mentor.
Right, exactly. Back then you had to be strong. You had to have 10, 15 guys with you. Because every night there was a fight. Every night. You know, it was tough back then. It was really tough. You know.
Did you get to listen to the Tony Stewart interview after Sonoma?
No.
There was a really good, I'll have to send you the link for it, Tony Stewart. It was revolving around the truck race when John West Hadley and Spencer Gallagher got into it after the last wreck they had right before the end of the race.
Yeah, I saw that.
And he was saying that John West Hadley's his new hero.
Oh, yeah. If you want to know what NASCAR's going to find him.
Yeah.
That's
16. What? Hang on a second here. What is this now?
That's 16. That should be him right there, Charlotte.
Number 16 at Charlotte. Okay. That was probably you. She's showing me some old pictures from Charlotte Motor Speedway. It looks like about a 55 to 57.
It's 1965.
Of 1965?
That's when the race was.
57.
Now, this is some pictures that she had. I don't know, are these from your family or something?
My dad.
Your dad took? Okay.
It's a 57 Chevrolet, number 16. It's got Joan Chevrolet on it, white Chevrolet.
No, this is a red one. With
this is a red one, and she said it's like from 1965 was when the race was.
65?
Yeah.
I had number 16 on it?
Well,
She thinks it may be you.
Number 16 was Tiny Lund.
Okay, we're
perfect.
Okay,
Daryl Derringer.
See, he knows everybody. Okay, he's going to tell you who.
Well,
it is.
He needs to go in through my pictures and
really
ID everybody for me. That would help.
I'll have to get her to shoot you a link.
I sent you a friend request
on Facebook.
So, and then if you go through, it says Charlotte Motor Speedway way down in all my pictures.
Number
15.
Yeah.
Ah. You can actually send the direct link for that group.
Okay.
But, anywho. What?
Ask him who was 30. Whoever.
I don't think he was a 37.
No, but does he know?
Oh, who was 37 back then in the 65 races?
37? Was that Skip Elliott?
I don't know. All I can tell is he wound up running off into the grass.
What color is the car?
White
car, red numbers.
37. No. 65.
What other numbers? She's just got a slew of pictures here from Charlotte Motor Speedway 1965 when her dad was out there and was taking a bunch of pictures and trying to just figure out who was who back then.
Yeah, right.
Now, in 65, you were still racing, right?
Yeah.
So, what number were you back then? 59. So now, tell us about some of the young kids that you've been helping lately, so we might know some of the future NASCAR kids coming along. See the whole thing up there.
Well, the latest one was that Matt Murphy. You know, he's coming up pretty good. You know, African boy, and he's coming up real good. And T.J. Michaels, he's in the Sprints now. He's doing real good. You know, and then Logano, David Reagan, and there was a bunch of young kids. You know, and Mike Joy's kid, I worked with him for 2 years. And Bruce Smith's grandson, I worked with him for a year. Graham Smith, in the Bandoleros. And then the Sir Douglas guy from Georgia, I worked with him. There's quite a few kids. Hunter Richards, he's running pretty strong right now.
Okay. Oh, I know what I meant to ask you about earlier. The new racing package that they're playing with, what are you thinking about? Well, how's that looking for those guys?
They better keep going stop. They're going to keep going the right way. They're going the right way. They're
going
to have to start doing something.
Yeah, I mean, I liked the way they were racing and everything. It put the actual feel of racing back into the driver's hands instead of just putting the foot to the floor and just pointing them here and go.
Yes, to get away from that downforce. Yep, you're right. Like I've been trying to preach, I told them to get back to the originals, you know, stock steel shocks, and get rid of all the fancy springs they got. The coil springs are up to $1,600 a piece now. So a coil spring, you know, it's way out of hand. You know, and it could be stopped. And NASCAR's on the right track of doing it.
It's almost like tell them, hey, go back to the old days, pull a stock car off the driver. I mean, off the dealer's floor. Go out there, make it a little safe, and then go race one of those things.
Well, that's what they want.
Well, today you got all that front wheel drive. It'd be too hard. You got that front wheel drive. They just need to go back to the stock bodies. The chassis are okay, the chassis, what they got today.
Yeah.
And just like that steel Munro shock. You know, you already went over 220 miles an hour with that shock. What's wrong with that shock?
Except for the stickers, you don't know one car from another.
Yeah, Mary was saying, without the stickers, you almost can't hardly tell who's who. Or what type
The guys need to go back to the stock body.
Yeah.
The way that car comes to the factory is the way that body should be put on it.
You should get on them boys, Mike Helton and all them guys, and just say, let's have a little Jesus.
Yeah, some of the Chevys are
Jesus
running Ford Lorenz, and
they know what they're doing. They wouldn't have the position if they didn't know what they're doing. They're definitely on the right track.
Well,
Go
ahead.
They need to get to, like I say, get back to the basics. You got to cut the cost. You got to get rid of all that fancy suspension. And the big brakes, the $25,000 brakes, and get rid of all those dynos they got, you know, shock dynos, all that computers. They need to get rid of all that stuff and go back. You can still race that way. There ain't nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, I mean, shoot, you got your regular, your Friday, Saturday night racers like in late models. They're still closer to regular stocks than what these guys are.
Well, I preached for years about going to a stock engine, and they're finally going to it. You know, Crate Motor.
Yeah.
So they're going on the right. They're going on the right track there. And Arca's got an engine now that lasts 5 races. So Arca's on the right verge there.
Yeah.
And now they're going to that composition body that Firestar makes. See, so they're headed in the right direction. They just got to get rid of all the fancy computers. That's what they got to do. Get rid of it.
Yeah, because they're going to look like they're turning into Formula One of the stock car world if they don't.
There they are.
29 cars, Arca has. What does that tell you?
They've got something going because you got enough cars to do a nice competitive show.
They only got 29 cars.
But yeah, they need to get more guys out there racing it.
Well, Well, they got to cut some more costs.
Yeah.
They
got to
cut.
Yeah, I mean.
Like I say, if they give rid of those big pit boxes and all the computers and get back to the basics, you'll get those guys back racing again.
Jeez, I mean.
ARCA better wake up quick.
Yeah.
Because they're on the verge. They're on the verge of having no cars.
I was talking with Joe Nemechek back a couple of years ago. He said, you know, we were talking about NASCAR needed to do the stock motor thing.
Oh, yeah. The crate motor. There's nothing wrong with that crate motor. Absolutely nothing at all.
Now, here. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was going to say, now here's an old school thing they used to do a lot of years ago when they did claimer rules. Can you imagine what would happen if they instituted claiming rules into Sprint Cup and Xfinity?
Yeah, but you got to get the price down. That's the problem. You got to get the price down.
Well, I mean,
five engines.
Yeah, I mean, but say for instance, somebody that's a backrunner, they decide they want to do a claim engine on Joey Logano's, and the price tag's only $20,000. You know, I guarantee you the prices on those engines to make those things would drastically come down if the ability to do a claim for $20,000 on an engine was available.
Well, I think it's too late, bro. I mean, Roger, I think it's too late in NASCAR. But ARCA and the short tracks need to do it.
Yeah.
You know, it's just too late now. The teams have too big of a building. They got too much staff. They got too many people. So it's going to be pretty hard to knock that down, and especially the engine shops they got, you know. So that's going to be pretty hard.
Yeah.
And ARCA's on the right track. ARCA's on the right track. They got a basic engine, but they got to get the cost down.
Yeah.
And yeah. Look at the trucks now. What they down to 32 trucks now in the race?
Yeah, I think they can go up to. Can't they go up to 36?
I think.
I think they can go up to 36, but they just haven't had that many showing up. I mean, I know.
What's it going to take to smarten up these promoters? What's it going to take? Can't they see it?
They got sunglasses on. That's all I can figure.
Well, they actually have 80 listed.
They were talking about Morgan Shepherd. All right, there was only 43 cars in the field. Hey, God bless Morgan. You know?
Yeah.
He's making money.
Yeah. Let's see. In the truck series, is it trucks you're looking up?
Yeah.
There's actually 80 drivers listed in the truck series.
Yeah, but what do you have? You know, I got four trucks sitting in my garage, you know, crashing trucks, and they're all dated. So what good is it, you know? You got to go down to that crate motor.
Yeah. What? How old are the ones you have at the shop?
2002. There's four of them sitting there just rotting away.
Was that the thing you were trying to do with Cody back then?
No, my grandson Tommy drove it.
Okay.
We ran only four races and I couldn't go no more and get no money.
And I know how you could get more money.
How do we do that?
We talked about it before. Get everybody that owes you money on bills from the shop.
You're right. You're exactly right. Do you know a driver back in the old days, 30, 40 years ago, the guy's name was Dean Dalton. He run number 7 car. I called him up last year, and I asked Dean, I said, Dean, I've got an old balance here. And he said, you mean we never paid? I said, no. Do you know what he made? Payments $1,000 a month and paid me off. And this is 40 years ago.
Oh, goodness.
Right. You know, I've collected over 45,000 from guys 40 years ago. Their payments.
Jeez.
Today I noticed one guy died, Tommy Watson. He died. He owed me some money. You know, it's just a shame that these guys they're dying and they won't pay it back. Does it make sense?
I mean, I can understand. I know about that stuff too, even though some of my stuff is in the computer world. And I've got friends that I've known forever and let them carry a decent balance. And then next thing you know, you're getting a call from the daughter and saying, oh my God, Dad passed away. you know?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And they won't pay it.
I was seriously tempted on this guy. He had just bought a Corvette.
Yeah.
I was going to suggest maybe I'll trade the Corvette for what he owed.
Exactly. Take anything he's got.
But, yeah, well, anywho. But, I mean, and the sad part is, for me, it was somebody I really had a good time with, known for a long time. He did a lot of things for me. He was a scallop boat captain, and whenever he came in, first thing he did was call me up, said, hey, let's go get together, and next thing I know, he's handing me 10 pounds of huge scallops, you know, about 4 inches across.
Uh-huh.
And so I can't complain too much about that, because I ate a lot of scallops from him.
Right.
But, I mean, it's sad. You got some people that are good, and some people, oh my gosh, I forgot.
Yeah, you're right. You're right.
Selective memory.
Yep.
So, are you keeping track of some of the young guns coming up? Who you think you might see as somebody that's going to be a new standout?
Roger, there's so many good kids out there for today, and they can't get in because it's going to take money to get in.
Yeah.
And it's a dirty standard. There's like this kid, TJ Michaels. There's so many young drivers out there on these local tracks, like Dave Grabo. You know, he's running the sprint cars. And they just ain't got the money to come here. And the first thing they ask you, how much money you got?
Yeah.
Then you get a ride. You know what I mean? That's what it came down to.
I mean,
it's down to how much money you got. You know?
I used to remember back in the day that teams had the money because they had the sponsors, and they just went out and shopped drivers.
That's right. And drivers were hard to find. You know?
Now you got tons of drivers and no money.
No money. Tons of good drivers, you know, sitting out there.
You keeping up with some of the K&N drivers that are coming up?
Yeah. But what good is it? I look at that and I said, poor kid, how's he gonna make it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I don't see no Winston Cup seats open. Do you see any seats open?
No.
I don't see none. Do you see anybody that's gonna retire?
Tony.
Well, there's already a driver taking over that.
Yep. Clint Boyer.
Yeah, so all these guys, these young kids today, they're all, you know, running short tracks, spending their money like crazy to get a NASCAR license. But how are they going to get in there? It's going to take them $2-3 million up front.
Yep.
And there's a few fathers that's got that kind of money.
Yeah, they're going to have to do the good old rent-a-ride and get into somebody's truck or somebody's Xfinity car that's going to run halfway decent to be able to show off their talent.
Exactly. Like Arthur, there's quite a few, you know, young drivers there.
Oh, yeah.
But they got to come up with the money.
Yeah, they're... whatever happened to Frank Kimmel?
Now he's a crew chief.
He's now a crew chief instead of driving after all those championships?
For that, they're Arthur girl. What's her name? Kelly? I forgot her name now.
Kelly Engstrom?
Yeah, it just ran the last race and he was crew chief of her.
Huh.
The number two car. I think it was number two, Arthur car. I think. So Frank Hill, that's what he's doing now, just being a crew chief.
Who?
And that's what it should be, you know, 38 years old, that drives me. You retired. Ted Jarrett was 37, Junior Johnson was 37, I was 38. You know, that's when all the drivers should retire and let these young kids come in there.
Yeah, you're talking about Sarah Cornett Ching.
Is that her name?
Yep, drives the number two car. Race 101 is the team.
Yeah, I think Kimball's crew chief in her.
Huh. Now, have you been following some of the ladies out here racing?
Not much, no. Not much.
I remember Joe
Allen. Roger, it just breaks your heart. You know they're not going to make it because they ain't got the money.
Yeah.
You know that. You know it deep in your heart. and you go to the racetrack and you see it, and like I said, I don't see no open seats in Cup. I don't see none at all.
Yeah.
Maybe a couple of years from now, Jimmy Johnson's going to quit. Maybe, who knows?
Well, you still
have... Right now, could you tell me that there's going to be an open seat next year?
The only thing I see as far as open seat type stuff would go would be like in the back markers, the number 30 team, the number 98 team, the number 95 team, the
78 team. His contract ends at the end of this season.
Martin Truex's contract ends at the end of this season, I was just told.
Right, but he'll have a ride.
Oh, I'm sure he will. But I mean,
yeah, that's it.
You got a lot of the back marker cars that'll have. Where they switch in and out drivers all the time. The number 52.
Sometimes top drivers are going to retire. Show me.
Yeah.
When they're going to retire.
Well, what? Within the next 2 years, we figure Earnhardt Jr. will retire?
Yeah, rumors are Earnhardt Jr. will retire in the next 2 years.
Who?
Earnhardt Jr.
Dale Jr.
I doubt that. He's making too much money. I doubt that. He makes $50 million just on souvenirs.
Yeah. Even when he retires, he'll still probably be making that.
Yeah, you're right. See, he's the kind of guy that can bring a young driver up like he's been doing.
Yeah. I mean, at least like with Brad Keselowski and a couple of the other drivers in the Cup Series that are having the truck and Xfinity teams, at least they're bringing some guys up. I mean, look at William Byron.
Yeah, right. Right. Now, I heard his family's pretty well off.
Yeah.
But he might make it.
Yeah, he's on the right track.
So he might make it.
So.
But whose ride are you going
to
buy?
Take over Clint Bowyer's old one?
Yeah.
You know, the only thing that's going to help some of the teams at the back is, you know, granted, getting more sponsorship money so they can upgrade their equipment.
Yep.
And be up there with the rest of the guys.
Just like that Moffitt kit. I heard his father's got quite a bit of money, but I heard he's running out with it.
Who was that?
Moffitt.
Oh, Brett?
Yep. But I hear he's run out of money. You can only spend so much.
That's true. You got to cap it somewhere. That's like, well, you know Robert Richardson Jr., right?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's like most of his stuff was financed by his dad's businesses.
Right.
And it just got to the point where, you know, this is costing way too much. They've had sponsors that they get on the car, and then the sponsors never paid. And,
right.
Well, Brendan,
he's
sponsored Victor.
By his dad's,
because
he
knows.
Who?
Clyde
Victor's. Okay.
Feed products. You know, without him, the kid would never have made it, because it took a lot of money.
Oh, yeah.
Brendan Gaughan's another one.
Brendan Gaughan supposedly is another one, too.
Well, his dad owns a casino in Vegas.
How much longer can this casino go?
How much longer can people keep losing to the casino?
Right, exactly.
I mean, and then what? Menard?
Mm-hmm. And, well, forget that. There's no end there.
Yeah.
There's no end there.
Is he going to keep racing until he's like Morgan Shepherd?
Menard's into everything.
Yeah.
His father. You know, they got so much money, and they make so much money. So just think about one thing right now. If Bill Gates... How much money is he worth?
More than you and I are combined.
And his buddy Bernard, Bill Gates' buddy, how much money is he worth? Just think if you got him to sponsor you.
Oh, yeah.
You know, a guy like Gates.
He has enough money, he could sponsor a whole freaking racing series.
The whole 43K, that's right.
He could create his own NASCAR.
And he keeps making it. That's the best part of it.
Oh, yeah.
he could spend it and spend it and spend it.
I'm still trying
to... That's what these young kids... That's what these young kids just got to get a hold of, people like that.
Yeah. I'm still trying to figure out why he, what the backdoor deal is going to be, is why he's giving away Windows 10 free. Everybody to upgrade it.
Yeah.
There's got to be something in the background that's looming that's going to turn around and bite you in the butt.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But like I said, it takes money.
Oh, yeah.
As long as NASCAR's got 43 teams, you know, that's all they need. And the shows ain't that bad.
Yeah, what did you think about when, I don't know if I ever, have I talked to you since they started doing this charter thing?
Yeah.
What did you think about that when they started instituting that?
Very smart. Now they got 35 guaranteed spots. It's not like ARCA, where ARCA's got 29 cars. ARCA doesn't know they're going to have 5 cars.
Yeah.
See, now NASCAR know they got 35
36.
Yeah. Now, but then, of course, they did go from 43 cars down to 40.
Well, they should have 43 charter spots, is what they should have.
Yeah. And personally to me, I don't care if they got some starting parks.
Right. So what?
The purse is there. Yeah. Somebody's gonna make
43 charges. If you had 43 Charger teams, you would have 43 top-notch drivers.
Yeah.
You would have them that stop and park guys.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? They'd be all top-notch. And that's where those young kids could come in. Because there's 8 spots open right there.
Yeah.
So you could have 8 new kids come in next year. Right off the bat.
Yeah, I mean, granted, if they can get the money to put behind them and NASCAR says, oh, we've got a new influx of drivers that got money, hey, let's open up the spots. And
there are 52 drivers listed.
What?
For the Cup.
For the Cup, there's 52 drivers listed.
Right.
In the Cup Series.
Mm-hmm. 46 have points, the rest don't.
And only 46 of them have points so far, so... The other ones are just waiting, I reckon, to get money to go put a car in the show.
See, with NASCAR having a guaranteed 35 field, they got TV rights.
Yeah.
Because now it's a guaranteed TV that they'll have 35 cars there.
Go ahead.
I think that's what TV wants guaranteed, that you're going to have cars. Not drivers, cars.
Yeah.
The only thing they got guaranteed is commercials.
Yeah, right now it seems like all they got guaranteed is commercials. Was it
47% was commercials?
Yeah, 47% of the last race was commercials. So you only got to
watch. You know how I do, Roger?
What?
I tape it, then I look at it 5 hours later.
And fast forward to the commercials.
Right, and I fast forward to commercials.
But you know what's even more fun? Just being there live.
Oh, yeah.
And if anything, to share time with somebody like you there.
Takes money, though. Takes money. You just can't go down the road. It's not cheap no more.
Well, you got a permanent hard card. You can go in anytime.
Yeah, but it still costs you to get there.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Somebody will give you a ride from Chicago.
If I can get you a ride to Martinsville, you'll come up there?
Of course I come up there. Why not?
Oh, good then. I'm going to make sure I find you a ride somewhere to get you up there.
David Reagan will bring you.
Yeah, David will bring you.
Oh, yeah, I know that. But then you got to find a place to stay. That's money. Then you got to have a car rental. That's money. You know what I mean?
Oh, well, if he gets you up there, I'll get you a place to stay, and we'll already have my car there, so what more do we need? Other than
now you're talking.
Here we go.
Now you're talking.
I'm going to get you...
I eat canned pork and beans, that's what I eat.
No, you come tailgate with us. We have really good food. And Jell-O shooters.
Yeah, she says you got to come when they do tailgate and they have really good food and lots of Jell-O shooters.
Oh, yeah.
When was the last time you went to a good tailgating party?
I don't think I ever did.
Oh my God, we have great tailgate. We have hamburgers, steak, shrimp, you name it. Nachos on the grill.
You never had time because you're always in the pits when you get there.
No, we get there early, bright and early.
Right, exactly. That's the way to go. You're right.
We're gonna have to get you planned up a good weekend at Martinsville. That's all there is to it.
I'm a motorhome freak. I love motorhomes.
I tell you what, if I had one, I'd be right up there sitting on that backstretch.
We were in the tent. We were cool.
Yeah.
We had
fun. I got one just rotting away, a 45 footer, just sitting here.
Good, then you can drive that to Martinsville.
Does it run?
Of course it runs.
Oh.
It takes big money to run it.
Well, it's not that far to Martinsville. Maybe, what, a couple hundred dollars to fill it up and get it there?
Let's keep going.
Oh.
Food, expenses.
We got the food covered. Food's covered.
Food's easy.
Yeah.
Well, we got the spot. That's only $100. We're done there.
That's all they charge you, $100?
Yeah.
Not bad.
Depends on which one you go to.
Well, we were on the hill right behind.
On the hill right behind it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's not bad. We're going to do some research on this tiger.
Okay.
We're going to get you into we're going to get you into trouble first class.
I'm good for that.
You can go trick or treating that weekend. You can be yourself.
and at night, all we need to do is kick up a little small fire, and we'll have Tiger Tom Pistone stories all night long.
Oh, my God.
Oh, we got that. Brian will take care of the fire. Brian's good. Shannon does a really good breakfast. She does biscuits and eggs and bacon. And
you're going to gain 10 pounds that
sausage.
Weekend, it sounds like.
She's all from scratch.
Are you coming to Charlotte race in October?
Say what?
Are you going to be here in Charlotte?
I won't be. I don't know about if Mary will.
I don't know. Jury's out on that one.
Oh, okay.
I don't get to go to as many as I used to, so I get to do like Richmond and Martinsville, sometimes Dover, and that's about it.
Charlotte's fun, especially my uncle, but his friends have a condo there in Turn 1. They always had some really good parties there.
Your friend got a condo in Charlotte?
My uncle's friend does.
Who?
My uncle's friend.
He has a condo in Turn 1.
Yeah, that's where Joe McCormick is. We got a condo there. And Stavola Brothers got a condo.
Okay. They have really good bourbon parties, that's all I
real good bourbon parties, okay.
We're on the third floor.
I don't remember which floor they're on. I'll have to find that out.
Oh,
yeah,
good.
Because Uncle Light takes his Carolina Panthers golf cart over there and leaves it for the whole week or 2 weeks and runs us all around in the golf cart.
What's his name?
Ike Faust.
Mike Stout?
Ike Faust. F-A-U-S-T.
S-T. I don't know what his friend's name is.
Faust. Okay. Yeah, Roy Hill's got a condo there. The drag racer, Roy Hill. Logano's got one. There's quite a few guys at Turn 1.
Cool. So what's on the rest of your plan for the night once you get done with us?
I've been watching that baseball game. I got it on tape.
Ah.
That All-Star game.
Uh-huh.
What'd you think about the home run derby? The kid that set that new big-ass record.
What is that?
The home run derby they had the other night?
I missed that.
Oh my God. What? It was like 60 or 70 home runs or something like that?
I missed that one.
Previous home run record was only maybe half of that. Yeah. He just kept knocking them out of the park. It's like back in the old days and you had an engine that was 200 horsepower stronger than everybody else's. You just walked the dog.
Right. Exactly.
Well, I tell you what, Tiger. I want you to go have some fun. Check out your TV on the baseball game.
Check out your Facebook because we sent you the link for some of the old photos.
Yeah, the Charlotte photos. We put it on one of your Facebook pages.
Okay.
So feel free to go tag whoever you think you remember the number of is, or just put a comment in it.
Okay.
And plan on being at Martinsville.
Definitely.
What day is that?
It's a Sunday race.
Hold on. I know that.
It's like the 30th or something.
It's usually around Halloween weekend. She's looking it up. She took my keyboard right to look it up.
Hold on, I got it right here. It is the 30th. I was right.
30th.
October 30th?
Yep.
29th will be the truck race and 30th will be the cup. We do both.
Okay.
So plan
on hanging out with us. Well, we always have a good time.
Plan on having some fun. That's all I can say.
Right.
We'll take care of you.
Okay.
Anywho, and anybody else you want to bring out to say hi, bring them one out. We'll have before too long. We'll probably have about 200 or 300 people hanging around by that time.
Okay, you got it, Roger.
All right, bud. You go ahead and have fun tonight, and I will talk to you later. Tell Chrissy I said hi.
Thank you. She's got that dog rescue. She's doing real good.
Yeah, the Frito.
Yeah, help her out with that.
I did some stuff for her. Actually did a couple of videos that we put out there to help bring people to help her out with that as well and getting the dogs taken care of.
Okay.
All right then. Well, I will talk to you later and have a good night.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you too.
Good night.
Good night.
Bye-bye. 56 minutes. Of Tiger Tom. What did I tell you before we started?
Hey, but still, it's not bad. We've been later in this before.
Oh, yeah. Well, I figured I better slack it off before. And I'm dead serious. We've had Tiger on there easily an hour plus, hour and a half. And we've had shows that have gone for 3 hours. We had one time we went to the NASCAR Sports Grill, did a live show from there. Mm-hmm. Some of the people that get wasted and come up behind you trying to figure out what's going on. I had one of the Xfinity drivers, a good friend of mine. He doesn't race anymore. And he'd come up from Charlotte to be up there for it. And we were interviewing him, talking, and some guy was really wasted. Came up behind him and asked him if he was gay. Right there in the middle of the show. Yeah. Later on, the guy came over, and he's apologizing the hell out of him. He said he didn't realize what was going on until afterwards. And because we had people in the sports grill that were watching the show and everything else. We probably had about 10 guests that night, and we ran for over 3 hours. We started at 7 and got done about 10:30.
Wow.
Oh, gosh. Kind of crazy shit we did. We had like 3 or 4 old timers, the guys that were back, you know, when Dale Jarrett's dad, Ned Jarrett, was racing type stuff, and even local old timer talent that were part of the Sprint Cup / Winston Cup / whatever it used to be called back then. I'm having a brain fart now. But anyway, all those guys, all the stories they had. It was totally worth it. So, yeah, and it's stuff like that is fun. Yeah, I love getting together, the people sit down and do a live show. Like if we could have Tiger, you know, I would probably set up something just to do a video of everybody there. And
would he come up for Richmond? Do it that Wednesday before Richmond. Could have him. I could bring him.
If we got the money together, hell yeah, he'd come.
Well, we got 9 weeks.
I wouldn't have to worry about finding a hotel or vehicles or food for him. I'd just take him home with me, just down the street. Oh. For those that are still watching, I know we went past our regular time. Sucks, but we enjoyed it. No news for those that are Langley race fans. Haven't heard anything new come up from anybody. The last thing I heard from anybody was Bill Mull said, I got the money. I'm just waiting on them. That's all he was allowed to tell me. So I have no other clues other than that. unless I get some sponsors and constructors, almost a $2 million check, then I could probably be knowing everything about it then.
Yeah. $2 million, I think I'd go somewhere else. Go live on the islands.
You can't get a race car. A couple million dollars ain't that much nowadays, really.
No. It's almost $1 million a weekend for some of those cup cars. You look at Hendrix.
Well, that's expensive racing. I mean, even for you and I, if we won a lottery, and I'd give this number because I've actually figured it out. If you've got $1.2 million, divide up $100,000 each month into tax-free notes with the government at 5%. You would go through and be able to live on $60,000 on interest every year.
Wow.
And you would still always have the $1.2 million in there. Now, $2.4 million? Hey, I can live off the $120,000 easily. I could actually do some racing again. Yeah, I tell you.
There's going to race anywhere in the world for that.
Shush. But there are some people out there that have gotten... that are trust fund kids. Mom and dad, something happened to them and double indemnity clause kicks in. I've had somebody come by here before, computer picked up, $5,000 for a computer. You know what his trust check is each month? $25,000. Each month.
I know a girl that does that. How much is there, don't know.
But he liked the computer so much he came back for another.
$25,000 a month, they can buy one every month.
Oh, geez, yeah. Jeez. Anywho, sponsored by PC Doctors and TechSpotUSA.com. TechSpotUSA.com for remote support. I figured I might as well throw that in there since we're at the end. Oh, anything else new? We haven't done much news talking. How'd you like the last race?
Well, you know, they talked about Martin. They said if Martin would drive like that every week to go down...
Uh-huh.
And go to the rear and come to, was it third?
Yeah. Then all he has to do is start a little better, like three spots, and he'll have it made each year, each time.
Exactly.
Now, you were telling me what happened after the race on inspection when they took it to NASCAR.
They pulled Brad Keselowski because he was the winner.
Right.
And I don't know how many they pulled, but let's just say that it was at least two randoms. So they pulled a Joe Gibbs car, they pulled Carl Edwards, and they chose the 78 car, the third car. And the jury's still out. They haven't announced or said anything about the 19 car. I guess the two car blew one through. 78 got rejected.
Rejected.
It's un... What did, how did I
did
say?
Did they say why?
Yeah, something with the drivetrain, and there's one other thing. I forgot what it was.
Well, heck. Let's do my favorite place to find this at.
J-Ski.
Used to be they had some sites where you could pull up and find out what all the different things were. Let's see here.
Oh, yeah. And then this week, Junie Donlevy's son died. Did you see that?
No, I did not.
Richard, right there, Richard Donlevy, 68. See it almost from at the bottom? I used to know Junie. He was really nice. I used to always go over there and have him pull my car into a shop, push the race car out and pull mine in. I thought that was tough stuff in high school.
Let's see here.
Yes, they had the sticker stripped, and it has to be fixed and recertified is what it is, uncertified.
Well, so basically just failed inspection, and they just have to redo it. I mean, it's no worse than having to go back through again in your line during the thing.
No, but usually when they just fail, they don't pull the stickers. They pull the sticker before they pull it out of the shop. So I heard.
All right, so where is it here? Penalty news and rules.
I don't know that they gave him a penalty for it. They did discuss on whether, about, I guess, the penalty that he did have. Right, there's a penalty for Atlanta, but that's not, that's last year. Isn't
it? Got Daytona, but they haven't put,
Kentucky
yet.
Maybe because as of today or this morning they hadn't said anything about Carl's. Maybe that's why they haven't posted it.
Did you finally get a chance, by the way, to watch that Tony Stewart interview I sent you? That was hilarious.
Yes, very funny.
And when he started talking about William Byron, I was texting him. William said, by the way, would you like to know that Tony Stewart is talking about you at the media interview? No way. I said, yep. So that was nice.
Mm-hmm.
So
now see, for Michigan, Truex failed the template inspection twice. But, you know, there was a lot of them that failed that.
Yeah, there was. I mean, you can see there's a long list. Some of them failed it twice.
Mm-hmm.
Keselowski, Earnhardt, that was Jeffrey Earnhardt, Brian Scott.
Well, there was even something for Brad that he failed last weekend, too, prior.
Hmm. Ooh, I didn't know Darrell Wallace got fined $15,000 for behavioral
lab. Oh, yeah, you didn't see that?
No.
Oh, my God, yes. Even Enfield Jen posted something about it, and somebody even made a hero card and put something about Darrell's mouth. Yes.
Yeah, what did they say? Wallace tweeted, got the Muppets up there officiating tonight. Never know how to react under pressure.
What a joke.
What a joke. Oh, my God. So he got a Tony Stewart fine.
Uh-huh.
Talk nasty about him.
Yeah, go to Facebook. It was all over Facebook.
I'll have to do that after. Let's get the show ended anyway.
Okay.
Everybody that stayed with us this long, thank you. And we hope to catch you back here next week on Let's Talk Racing. Let's do some laps.